Go ahead.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the Court, Anthony Dane, appearing for Sei Kim. What I'd like to do is go to the path of least resistance to demonstrate to the Court that the district court's determination that as a matter of law, this factual scenario could never be covered is clear error.
The patent mark claim?
Yes, and let me start with this. Patent marking, if you read, and I'll start with the code section, 35 U.S.C. 292. False patent marking is false advertising. It's not a patent claim. I mean, the simplest way to know it's not a patent claim is this case went up to this court at one point and came back down, and this court doesn't hear patent claims. The Federal Circuit does. It's a false advertising claim. And let me just, and because there are many facets to, but I'll read it as to the lines that apply to this case. Whoever without consent of the patentee marks upon or affixes to or uses in advertising in connection with anything made, used, or offered for sale, the words patent, quote, with the intent of deceiving the public and inducing them to believe that the thing was made, offered for sale, sold, or imported into the United States by or with the consent of the patentee is a violation. So using the term patent, marking it on the device, on the advertisement, the box that the device was sold in, is a violation if one doesn't hold the patent. And as the court said, this doesn't, the court's decision is a matter of law that it could decide the case. All it was doing was interpreting a provision that's clear on its face. It didn't really need to be interpreted. Advertisement is a notice that is broadcast or published to the general public or specific market segments about your goods. On the device, on the box.
I mean, the problem is, as I understand it, that although a definition of advertising injury might include this suit for a competitive injury because of the false marking, it doesn't. I mean, or at least the argument is that it doesn't, in the sense that there is a specific definition in the policy for what an advertising injury is, and it has to be essentially either a disparagement or a usurpation of an advertising idea as applied here. And in other words, I'm saying what you're saying, you know, might be good English, that in the sense that this might be considered an advertising injury, but it isn't the way the advertising injury is defined in the policy.
No, it actually is, and I want to jump on something you just said. Might. The key is here.
Well, I think you're wrong about that.
No, California law is clear that if there's a potential for coverage.
But that means something else. It doesn't mean that if anybody in their right mind might think that this policy covers this thing. It means that if in the course of the litigation it might develop that there's coverage. But once you know that you still end up litigating under the actual policy provision once you know what everything there is to know about how this case is going to develop. And at this point, we knew everything there was to know about how the case was going to develop.
Okay, and let's discuss how the case was going to develop. The manufacturer of this device was Sei Kim. Sei Kim was selling it exclusively through Cyclone. Sei Kim put patented on his devices and on the boxes that were sold.
So how does that disparage?
Is your
theory that it disparages?
This is why I'm taking the path of least resistance that gets you there. Let's go with the advertising use of another. The use of another's advertising idea.
Somebody else's advertising idea.
Idea.
Okay,
exactly.
So how is it that? They stamped the word patent.
When you put the word patent on a device and on, as it says in 292, advertising, on the box, what you're doing is telling the public, and in this case, they call them shade tree mechanics, people that fix their own cars. this device is special, it's unique, it works the way you want it to work because it has a patent. Under the patent laws, nobody...
How is that somebody else's advertising idea?
Because, okay, and this is the confusion. You don't need to be the first to ever come up with this idea. There's no requirement of that, nor...
But how is it even your idea? If the stamp said, you know, we're the only patented one, first one, original one, that might be a disparagement, but I'm looking at advertising idea.
Yeah, so let's forget disparagement for a moment.
Okay.
Sei Kim, since 1994, this is 8 years before this knockoff, had marked the device as patented, mm-hmm. and the box that it's advertised in. People look at that. When you look at a product, if it's patented, you make certain assumptions about it. So the use of the word patented on a device is an advertising idea. It's a marketing idea.
They have to use somebody else. They have to be using the idea of the perpetual suing, and everybody in the world puts patented on. So why is that?
You know why? Because when you're taught in marketing 101, when you convey to customers and want to attract customers, you tell them your device is patented.
I know, but how did they usurp the idea of the other Kim?
Because it was Sei Kim that it was his idea to put patented on his device and on the boxes. Cyclone was simply the distributor of that. When Cyclone knocked off its own device, what it did is put it in the box that's using Sei Kim's testimonial, Sei Kim's testing, and Sei Kim's use of patented, and simply and sold it within that. He did not have the patent. So the idea to use patented was Sei Kim's. He was the original manufacturer.
And, you know, 9 jillion other people.
It doesn't matter.
But what this statute is about, and we've just said this in case law, it's about using somebody else's manner or means of advertising their product.
It is the manner and means that Sei Kim used to advertise his product. Doesn't mean others can't advertise different products. Remember, there was no other product on the market like this. There were only two devices.
Well, the product may be unique, but the advertising idea isn't.
There is no case that says the advertising idea can't also be an idea that others employ. If you go to marketing school, if that's your experience, you're taught here are the things you should always do in marketing. But if it's your device, you can pick and choose which ones you use. You're not required to mark a device or put on the packaging that is patented. You don't have to. That's an issue for infringement
and damages.
Well, for one
thing, I mean, it isn't even accurate because Sei Kim's idea was to put patented on his box because it was patented. And his idea was to put patented on the box even though it wasn't patented.
No, let me stop you there. You say his idea was to put the word patented because it was patented. It is not required, but it gives him an advantage, so he took advantage of that advertising idea.
No, but I'm
idea.
Saying that his idea was to put a false statement as to patented, as opposed
right.
to a
and
true statement of patented. It's
exactly.
not even the same idea.
It is the same idea. It's using the word patented. He just didn't have one. The false patent marking...
It seems to me that would work if he used his brother's logo. But you seem to be saying that he's got this exclusive right to use the word patent is his advertising idea.
You're making that's where we have the problem. It doesn't have to be his exclusive idea; it just has to be his.
So let's
idea.
Look at our case law then, counsel. Did you ever allege anywhere that he used his brother's manner or means of advertising?
That is what we're alleging. His manner or means of advertising is to use the word patented in his marketing.
Right, can we talk about disparagement for a while, which I know you don't seem to want to embrace, maybe because of the recent California Supreme Court case, but and this is merely my question. The strongest theory I can think of for you, and I just don't know whether there's actually, this is disparagement, is really, for some reason it's been left out of everything here, that he also used the same name. Right, it was
correct.
Tornado 3, and then it was Tornado 2. So basically, the question is, by putting this false name patented on his box, he was essentially saying, "We're as good as this other one with a similar name."
Or better. because you're now selling a different device than the authentic one under the same
name.
Well,
all right, but yes? is that disparagement if it's not true that we're the same? Where, in other words, the relative ranking, he's essentially saying, where our relative, it isn't, what we're disparaging is the notion that these guys are better because they're patented, because we're claiming we're also patented, so we're as good as them. I don't think that works as disparagement, but that is, seems to me to be the only possibility.
No, the disparagement, as the and the trial court made a finding of this, that he was using the word patented on the device to deceive customers that his device was as good as or better than the device he had previously been selling, which was the authentic device. So while it may puff up his device, it's also saying mine is as good as or better. And if you have a finding by the court that it's in any way using the word better, that's a disparagement of Mr. Kim's device. And under 292, it allows you to sue for a competitive injury. The unfair business practice of false advertising includes that, disparaging the
when
device.
When you say competitive injury, that's with a change in the statute, correct?
That's the change of the statute.
But
which
that didn't exist at the time of the judgment in the underlying case.
No, right? But it existed at the it existed before Peerless
withdrew. When did they withdraw?
Peerless withdrew after the Court of Appeal, this Court of Appeal, remanded the case for a calculation under the new and revised 32 U.S. 292, which had included the competitive injury.
Did they withdraw from the case before we issued our opinion or our memorandum?
No. They withdrew from the case when it became clear that this was being remanded for a calculation on damages. So that's when they withdrew from the case.
There are several letters of withdrawal.
Yeah, they're earlier it was their letters weren't of withdrawal. Their letters of were statements were not covering.
Right, we're
not,
no longer going to represent
right.
you. Right.
What happened is, and this is what is in the record. They said this is questionable. It was in their right. notes. They found out that Mr. Kim, J. Kim, was ill, and he was in financial trouble. After all of that is when this court's remand is when they withdrew. That was at the time they withdrew. So how, when the court adds that you now have a right
when
to
did
sue,
they, when did they determine that they were that there was no longer that they were certain that there was no longer a potential for coverage?
After this court remanded to the district court for a calculation of the competitive injury damages.
Well, in their view, it was only because it was patent.
And again, right? That's the point. It's not a patent claim. It's a false advertising claim. Okay. And I'm sorry. I don't want to.
I just thought that what was left. In their view, that was all that was left. That's all I meant.
It's a very hard sale. For me to think that patent is somebody else's advertising idea, and I haven't been very subtle about that. But it might be a disparagement claim, it seems to me. And I think you have an uphill battle there too. But at least there could be an implication there that, you know, we're patented and you're not.
But you understand what I'm saying is to find as a matter of law that it cannot be an advertising use of another's just because many people use patent, or that it cannot be a disparagement because it doesn't specifically say I'm disparaging you, is improper. There's still the potential for coverage.
What
That's
do you
a
mean
question
by the
fact.
Potential for coverage? This has gotten very mixed up over the years, as I understand the case law.
Yes.
And I don't understand potential for coverage to mean it could be somebody might think it was covered. What it means, I mean, at some point you have to make a decision whether it is or isn't covered, the court
and
does.
That's a question.
And it's a question of what?
It's a question of fact, not a question
Why
of
is it law. A question of fact?
Because there is it's, no...
This is a contract, like any other contract.
And the
contract... And the question, the potential for coverage is, for example, if you bring an action, in this to take this case, if you had brought an action for defamation and for breach of contract, but you couldn't, and suppose those weren't covered, but you could, there was still a potential for coverage because as the case went on, maybe they were going to allege something else on these facts. All right, that would be a potential for coverage. Or we don't know which way the case is going to come out on the facts. That's a potential for coverage. But once we know that there's nothing in this case but this false mark issue, there never will be anything else in the case other than the false mark issue. There's no potential left. It either is or isn't covered.
No, but see, there is no, what you're saying is there's no question that it's under either use of another's advertising idea or disparagement.
And it either is or isn't. It either is or isn't.
But then it's a question of fact whether the use of patented in an advertisement on the box on the device, when there's no legal requirement.
It may be a question of fact, but it's summary judgment. It's subject to summary judgment.
Wait, but counsel, why? Isn't it true that it has to specifically refer to plaintiff's product?
No, that's now you're getting into disparagement, and that's by implication.
That's what I'm trying to get to.
That's right.
Exactly.
I understand.
That's how the policy defines this.
No, it can be by implication. When, look, the only other product, the patented product, was Sei Kim's.
Under so the Swift case, doesn't it have to refer to the other product specifically?
The Swift case said you can have disparagement by implication. There are only two products, so the comparison is to the prior product that they were distributing.
So is the answer to my question, you think it doesn't have to refer to the other product?
It does not have to refer to the name of the other product or the manufacturer of the other product or that it was the prior product. The fact of it can be by implication. And I'm sorry, the only thing, and I may be getting on your nerves on this, Judge Bersan, but the only thing I want to say is the question of fact is just very specifically, is it on the right to the advertising idea of another is, if a person uses patented on their product, is that an advertising idea? And a jury would have the right to say yes or no. You cannot, as a matter of law, say that I deem.
Well, you would have to instruct the jury about what advertising idea meant. And if an advertising idea meant, as one might think, something that was not patently obvious to the whole rest of the world, then he loses. And that would be the instruction to the jury.
If that's the instruction you gave, at least there's an instruction because it's not a defined term in the policy.
All right, but so that's what I'm saying. If our conclusion is that that would be the instruction, and under that instruction, no reasonable jury could conclude that this was an advertising idea, then you lose.
Then if that was the case, that would be an improper instruction. It would be because you can't say an advertising idea can only be one no one else has come up with.
All right.
Sorry. Thank you.
Thank you.
Almost good afternoon. May it please the court. My name is Scott Svezlowski, and I'm here for the appellee Peerless. I'd like to first start by describing what this case is not about. This is not a case about an insurer that denies coverage at the outset of a case. This is not a case about an insurer that withdraws the defense in the middle or right before trial. Peerless defended Sei Kim's brother and his brother's company, Cyclone, for nearly 9 years. Trial through an appeal. Peerless did not withdraw the defense until after this court issued a remand, and Sei Kim irreversibly limited his case to one claim and one issue, and that was the calculation of damages under Section 292. That was the only thing that was left. And at that time, Peerless withdrew coverage, and it properly did so because it's not, false patent marking is not an enumerated offense under the policy. It does not qualify as disparagement under controlling case law from the California Supreme Court as well as numerous decisions from this district. Nor does it qualify as the use of another's advertising idea in your advertisement.
So let me ask you this. So when our court sent it back for trial,
yes,
in light of the new, on the damage amount, in light of the new statute, competitive injury, what would have been contemplated under that?
The only thing left was the proper measure.
What was competitive injury? What does competitive injury mean?
Any harm that was suffered. the harm that was suffered from the false patent.
So how would they prove up without?
Well, I can say how they did do it. They did it first by declaration and motion.
No. I mean, what's the competitive harm?
That's a good question. I do not know what their alleged their competitive harm would actually be, because here
would it be the use of their idea?
But it wasn't. It wasn't the use of their idea. The charge was that Cyclone had stamped patented on a device that was not in fact patented, with the intent to deceive the public. There was no allegation that by doing so that this specifically disparaged Sei Kim's product, and that's required.
But what about his argument is that it could be disparagement by implication? Yeah. And so, if the implication is, you know, we're patented, as I said, we're patented, and you're not. We're the first. We're the original. What about that implication?
Right. Great question. And the California Supreme Court in Hartford v. Swift rejected a similar argument.
Well, we just went over that with Swift.
Well,
it didn't specifically refer to, or why doesn't it qualify?
Well, if I may, in that case, the insured there said, "Well, I'm triggering coverage because I impliedly disparaged my competitor's product by saying in my catalog, in my advertisements, that my knockoff product was patent pending." The California Supreme Court said, "That's not specific enough. That doesn't necessarily mean that somebody else's product is inferior."
But was it not specific enough, counsel, because it didn't refer to the other product?
Both. It doesn't specifically refer to another product.
I don't know why this doesn't refer to it. It has the same name. I mean, if it's calling itself Tornado 3 and that was Tornado 2, it's suggesting, even by the numbers, that Tornado 3 is better than Tornado 2. I mean, it's not just in the sky, so why isn't it referring to Tornado 2?
The California Supreme Court has made it clear that you must have a false or misleading statement
that specifically refers. That's a different point, okay? So therefore, and this is essentially what I said to your opposing counsel, so why is it or isn't it disparagement to say to imply pretty strongly that we are just as good, or he says they said as good or better, than Tornado. We're Tornado 3, and we're patented, and Tornado 2 is patented, so at least they're no better than us. And so in ranking, in other words, ordinarily, it isn't that they're better than us because they're patented. They're really the same as us. So is that disparaging of Tornado 2 by saying that they're not at a higher level than we, they're really at the same level? Is that disparagement?
No, and this court
now,
has...
Now, why not?
Well, this court has rejected that argument on several occasions. The court in Homedics, in Microtech, in Bullpen, in KFX just last year, this court has rejected that argument and said claims of equivalence are not enough.
But it's Tornado 3.
It's
my newer iPhone. It's got a bigger number on it.
And that's a true statement. It is a Tornado. Right. Correct. What they're claiming is the false statement is that you stamp patented.
Right.
Well, but that's the charge under 292. There's nothing else.
Now you're responding differently to Judge Berzon's
question. I'm sorry.
I'm not trying to be difficult, but her hypothetical, which I think is really interesting, and it's one I kicked around with my law clerk as well, goes to this using Tornado 3 in conjunction with patented. But I think the allegation is patented, that's the advertising idea or the disparagement, just the word patented.
Right, and it's neither. You don't disparage, and the California Supreme Court said...
But they got a competitive injury damages, presumably, because there was enough connection between, inherent connection between these two products, that if by falsely marking Tornado 3 as patented, it affected the market in Tornado 2. Why? Presumably because people thought, oh, this is at least equivalent or better product than Tornado 2, so we think we'll buy it, right? So they're knocking, I mean, you gave me a bunch of cases and I'm not acquainted with why you are so firm that they say that when you're saying when X is really better than Y, and you're saying it is, oh, it's not better than Y, it's the same as Y. Why isn't that disparaging X?
Well,
from by saying, you know, you may think they're better than us, but they're not better than us. They're no better than us.
This court has rejected the argument that claims of equivalence or even claims of causing consumer confusion.
Claims of what? I'm sorry.
That claims of equivalence
or
causing consumer confusion are enough.
It's not confusion. It's not about confusion. Give me an example of one of the equivalence cases. What were the facts? I don't have them.
For example, in Bullpen, the insured was accused of passing off a competitor's achievements and services as its own on their website in an actual publication. They were sued by the competitor, and the insured said, well, that triggered coverage because there's an implied disparagement. The court there, this court said, that's not enough. That's not enough to, there's no actual allegation that just because you're passing off somebody else's goods or services or products as your own, that does not mean that you are expressly or impliedly disparaging somebody else. You could have those same achievements. The other party could also have those same achievements discussed on the party's website. That's not enough. And this court
isn't a passing off problem. It's that they marked the box in a way that, and I don't know whether this flies, but it just seems to me. I mean, if I were simply using the term disparagement in some ordinary English way, I would think, well, you are disparaging a superior product by saying it's actually not a superior product. That's disparaging it.
The California Supreme Court in Hartford v. Swift said using terms such as superior and innovative or unique are not enough.
That's a puffing, I understand.
Exactly.
That, but that's not what happened here.
Well, what happened here was not a mark on a box, but instead a mark on a product. And that mark on the product, just by stamping patented, there's nothing...
I'm sorry, we're not talking about the mark on the box?
No, we're not. They're complaining about stamping the word patented on a product that they allege was a cheap, inferior knockoff. They've never said that they were offering for sale something that was better. They never said that they were offering for sale something that was unique or special or that another competitor, you know, did not have. This is different than those cases that have it recognized impliedly that when somebody says, I am the only owner of a trademark or I'm the only producer of a software, well, if you do that to the exclusion of everyone else, well, that's necessarily by implication going to disparage your competitor because it's going to suggest that, well, they don't also have that.
Even if it doesn't refer specifically to their product under
Swift? It would do so, well, in those limited cases, it would do so only by implication.
If I said I'm the only one.
I'm the only one.
Yeah, okay.
Right. And so when you stamp patented for what? The design, the function? What is that conveying? All that conveys is that the holder of this product thinks that they can presumably patent the product or that they have permission to do so from the USPTO.
What would they have to show to get competitive? What was open at the time that the lawyers withdrew was the damages, the
Correct.
Competitive damages. What did they have to show to get to competitive damages?
They would have to show that by Cyclone marking its product patented when it wasn't, that it somehow suffered some sort of competitive harm.
I understand that, but how do you do that?
That's a good question, Your Honor. I don't know how you do that. But
they still had the availability of just the statutory damages.
Well, right? the $500 statutory. Yes, I believe.
But the
so.
Remand was for damages, and that's the point at which the lawyers pulled out.
That's correct.
So if the competitive damages bear a pretty good relationship to a disparagement claim, then you'd think they couldn't pull out. So I'm trying to find out whether the competitive damages would essentially require some showing that people who would have liked Tornado 2 before understood that Tornado 3 was in some sense saying Tornado 2 is not as good as you, not any better than we are, and therefore because we're both patented, so it's not a superior product, so you should buy ours. I mean, it's something like that must have been going on in the competitive damages notion.
Well, even if it was, we have to remember the procedural posture of this case is critically important. This isn't a time where they could amend a counterclaim and assert disparagement.
I understand the time that. Had passed. That's They'd why already I'm gone focusing on what they actually had to show to get the competitive injury.
Right, and so because of the procedural posture, and because they were limited only to those damages, then the court would have to equate false patent marking with disparagement.
But we said they could show competitive damages.
I'm sorry?
We said in that remand that they could attempt to show competitive damages under the new statute.
A competitive injury, right?
Right, that's true.
Or competitive injury.
So what would they have shown?
Well, I could only speculate as to what they would have tried to show.
Is there another case in the world where anybody has ever gotten a competitive injury for false patent marking?
Oh, I'm sure. I mean, if you like, we can.
Well, I mean, there may not be because it was a pretty recent amendment. And that's why I'm kind of wondering.
Right. No, I do not know what they would have to show. What I do know is that they couldn't show disparagement. And that's because what's missing from here and what this court recognized in Microtech and a number of other cases is that if you don't actually have a disparagement claim, there's not going to be coverage for it. There has to actually be a statement, a false or misleading statement that disparages your competitor.
Can I ask a question?
If there were a overlap between the two in the sense that what you had to show to get the competitive injury was essentially something that you would also meet disparagement, then it would work. And I don't know the answer to that because nobody seems to know what you have to show to get the comparative injury.
I would say under that hypothetical, if this case was still at the pleading stage or even before trial, what that would mean is that there was perhaps a potential.
That's just not right.
But that's the duty to defend, Your Honor. I know that, but
I'm asking what did they actually have to demonstrate at the point that this case was, which was at the point of competitive injury, what were the elements of that? Nobody knows.
They have to show that they suffered harm from cyclones.
And how are they going to do that under these circumstances? Presumably they're going to have to show something about how consumers would have reacted to this false patent marking, which would have led them to buy this instead of that, right?
Possibly. That's possible. But what's still missing is any specific disparaging statement that specifically refers to, say, Kim's goods or his business and necessarily derogates that product or business.
At the time J. Kim started marking his product patented?
Yes.
Had, say, Kim marked his products?
His product was also patented, yes.
So I'm asking about chronologically, at the time Jay started using that mark, the stamp.
Correct.
Were the products coming out of Korea also marked that way?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I thought I did. Yes. The Sei Kim had already been marking his product patented.
Okay, so here's why I'm asking the question, sure. Counsel. I'm trying to, your opposing counsel thinks this is a path of least resistance, and I'm struggling with that. But what if he thought, because after all, the ruling was as a matter of law. What if he thought, okay, my brother Say thinks this is his idea. This is how he's going to advertise his product by marking it patented. Right. So I'm going to steal that idea by marking mine patented too. That's the only way I can possibly think this is a stealing somebody else's advertising idea. And I had originally understood that at the time he started stamping his product, the other didn't have the stamp. But is that wrong? You said it's wrong. Chronologically, it's wrong. So why isn't it a stealing somebody else's idea?
Well, 2 points. One, the Tornado product is not an advertisement. That's the argument.
No, but his argument is that the stamping it patented is the advertising idea.
Correct, but it has to be the use of an advertising idea in your advertisement.
Yes.
The only advertisement that they've identified is the product itself.
Use of another's advertising idea in the insured's advertisement.
Correct.
Okay, so you're saying there isn't one and the same. He didn't use that on a box? At least that's not the claim.
Correct, for false patent marking. Because for false patent marking, there's only two things. A false mark and intent to deceive. That's it. So his problem
then is, to answer my question, because your time, you're over, is the stamp was on the product, not on a catalog or a box or anything else, not in an advertisement?
That is what is alleged. That's what was proven at trial. That was the only issue on remand.
And it's not covered for that reason.
It's not covered because the product does not qualify as an advertisement as the policy defines advertisement.
Your ultimate argument is that this wasn't an advertisement at all?
The product itself was not an advertisement. Does not
fit
with
stamp on it?
Well, and that would not be an advertising idea. And that's because the way the policy defines what an advertisement
is. But is it an advertisement for purposes of the disparagement rule?
No, it's not.
Your ultimate argument is just not an advertisement.
The product itself is, it's not an advertisement.
And the stamp on it's not an advertisement either.
It's not an advertising idea. That's correct.
I didn't ask you that.
It's not an advertisement. No.
For purpose of the disparagement.
That's correct.
It's not an advertising injury, period, the end, because it's not an advertisement.
Correct.
Why did we just talk about something else for 15 minutes? And it's...
Happy to discuss whatever you like.
Answer this
question. No, but I never understood you to be arguing that. I thought the whole premise here was exactly that at least the stamp on the product, I thought it was the box, frankly, I will ask your opposing counsel, but whichever it is, was an advertisement. The question was it an advertising injury of the particular kinds that are covered? Now you're telling me it's not an advertisement at all.
That's great. It doesn't come within the policy's definition of an advertising injury or an advertisement. It's not within the insuring agreement under the policy itself.
Okay. Great.
Okay.
We'll take that as your last statement.
Fair enough. Thank you very much.
Okay. Yes, you can have a minute for a rebuttal.
I need to correct two things. One, I think I know where the disconnect I had with Judge Person is, but I want to address this first. This court remanded for a determination of competitive injury under the newly enumerated statute. So you can't argue that you're shot out because you didn't do at the pleading stage what had not yet been required of you.
Is it true that the only issue here is the stamp on the product as opposed to on the box?
No. No, what we would be allowed to do in terms of proving a competitive injury is the false advertisement, because there is an advertisement not just on the product. People pull it out and look at it on the product, on the box, but also you mentioned the
cycle. On the box or on the product?
Both. On the box, in the product,
in
brochures.
Why does he say then that you're only complaining about the stamp on the product, not the stamp on the box?
Because originally the false marking claim under the old statute was a marking of the device.
Did you ever allege anything other than the stamp on the product?
I honestly don't recall. I don't recall because that wasn't under the old statute.
That's the answer to Judge Berzon's question.
Yes.
The reason he says that is because I don't think you've ever alleged it was on a box.
But let me explain why we need to correct something. Prior to this, under 292, it was a penalty statute. So if the product was not marked, it was marked, you had penalties. We cannot get penalties under the new statute. That's confined to only the United States. We must get competitive injury, and that's where you're allowed to prove the advertisement beyond just, I said, patented on my device. We're allowed to show how they advertise it, which, by the way, the knockoff was now placed in a box. Not only saying the new Cyclone, but it was using testimonials. It was using
But counsel, on remand, did you make that allegation?
We didn't get to it because remember, Jay Kim died. First of all, on remand, his attorneys were gone.
Okay, fair enough. Apart from today, when you're standing at the podium, did you ever make the allegation that there was this that you used this advertising idea an advertisement?
Hold
on. Not that we use the advertising idea, because understand, this was remanded. We didn't represent Jay Kim and Cyclone
counsel,
at the time.
It's a simple question.
No, because we didn't represent Cyclone. They did not use that. Their attorneys abandoned them. Then we reached the settlement with Cyclone, and then we took over. So the first time we can discuss it is after the fact.
If you don't have an allegation that another's advertising idea was used in your client in the insured's advertisement, you don't have a covered event.
No. We do have a covered event because of the competitive injury remand. That's how you prove
competitive. But the competitive injury remand, as I understood it, was to get a competitive injury for what you'd already succeeded in establishing liability for, not starting all over again.
Oh, no. And we did in the original complaint. It was not under the false marking. The complaint, like when you allege a false marking claim, you incorporate everything that's in the rest of the complaint. In the complaint, we said that they used Sei Kim's advertising, including the Cyclone name, including the box testimonials.
Where?
Including
where? That's what I've been asking, counsel. Where?
It's in the complaint. I'm sorry.
In the underlying complaint.
The underlying complaint.
Right. Is it in the record?
That was Sei Kim's. Yes, that's on the record. That was Sei Kim's allegation of Jay Kim. What Jay Kim, at the time, again, you have to remember the chronology. This gets remanded to prove a competitive injury, which can be not only disparagement, as you're saying now I've got a Cyclone 3, I need to correct something. Cyclone 1 was ours. Cyclone 2 was a device that had what was called a bullet in the middle that actually shot through the motor and caused a damaged engine. So they quickly changed to this third device, but both of those were knockoffs. The third device was also stated as patented. So it was really saying from Cyclone to this, Tornado to Tornado 3, this third tornado. So they had done this twice. But in the underlying complaint, we proved false advertising.
You mean alleged?
We alleged. No, the court found it. It just didn't find damages for that. It found false advertising.
So that would be helpful to know.
Under the Lanham Act, and it found unfair competition based on this false marking. But what the court said is it was confined to a $500 penalty because that's what the statute, it understood the statute to be. So what I want to say is on remand, Cyclone had the right and Sei Kim had the right to prove the competitive injury, which is where the disconnect is. Now I understand, Your Honor, what you're getting at. The disparagement is, yes, now you were selling my product as Tornado. Now, I don't know you're doing this, but suddenly you stop using the one I'm using, you stop buying from me, and you put in the box with my name, my testimonials, my testing, and the word patented that I had on my devices beforehand. Sei Kim had, since 1994, used patented. Cyclone was selling Sei Kim's device in the United States. Then they start saying, ours is now patented. And so, again, I get to, as a matter of law, to say that we can't prove competitive injury because the word patent, whether it's
on
the device...
Well, they're not saying you can't prove competitive injury. They're saying you can't prove disparagement.
Which is part of...
Did the case ever get to the point of anybody spelling out what would have to be proved for competitive injury?
It did not. It's settled because...
I know.
Jay Kim had no attorneys, and he died of brain cancer. This was 6 months before he died. He had no attorneys... No way to defend himself. Yeah,
we've let you go a long time.
I'm sorry.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honors.
And our last case for argument this morning is King versus Blue Cross.